Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness.
The Bible contains remarkable stories of miracles and divine interventions. Moses parted the sea. Peter healed a man lame from his mother's womb. Jesus drove demons out of people and raised others from the dead. But are these types of events still happening today?
We too have a beam of divine light and guidance that God has put within the heart of every man. And it's one of the greatest proofs that there is a God.
More amazing supernatural things are happening than we realize.
This is Divine Intervention, the interview show that features intriguing people who've experienced the hand of God in amazing ways. Divine Intervention was created and produced with the purpose of encouraging believers, spiritual seekers, and skeptics alike that Jesus is alive and is still performing miracles and working in the world today.
I believe in miracles.
Here's your host, Daniel Fazina.
Hello, friend, and welcome to Divine Intervention Radio. I am your host, Daniel Fazina. And this is the number one show that talks about the miracles of Jesus. Friend, we've got an amazing guest in store for you today who's got some powerful testimonies of how the Lord has worked in his life. But before we get to him, I'd like to remind you that if you miss any of the shows, you can find us online. DivineInterventionRadio.com is the website. On Facebook.com/DivineInterventionRadio and also on YouTube, YouTube.com/DivineInterventionRadio. Friend, today's special guest is the Reverend Dr. David Chotka, and he is the founder and director of Spirit Equip Ministries. Spirit Equip is designed to equip and train your spiritual life for success one small step at a time. His website is spiritequip.com, and the Reverend Dr. David Chotka is also the author of the book Healing Prayer is God's Idea, and we're going to have some amazing stories of some healings that God has done in his life. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Reverend Dr. David Chotka right now on Divine Intervention Radio. Dr. David, welcome to Divine Intervention Radio. It's a pleasure to have you. Thanks for joining us.
Well, thank you for inviting me to be part of your program. I'm delighted to be here.
Well, it's an honor and a privilege for me as well. I was very excited to talk to you on our Christian Authors Mastermind with our good friend Steve Harrison. And getting to know you and some of the amazing things God has done in your life has been very inspirational for me, and I thought it would be for our listeners here on Divine Intervention as well. So why don't we go to the beginning a little bit? Tell us about your background growing up and you know, what it was like for you, and then maybe how you came to faith in Jesus in the first place.
Sure. My parents are Eastern European people whose parents moved to Break Prairie soil in Alberta, rather in Saskatchewan and Manitoba. So I'm 100% pure-blooded Ukrainian, if that means anything to your listening audience.
Okay.
At any rate, they were hardworking people, and they wound up establishing a restaurant, and I grew up serving customers and waiting on tables and those kinds of things. But, you know, the faith was not something that was strong. There were little aspects of it all through my childhood, like Mom had a children's Bible and so on that she read to us. But really, that wasn't part of our regular routine. If you could, anything you could call us, you could call us C&E attenders, you know, Christmas and Easter.
Right.
At any rate, grew up 12 miles north of Niagara Falls. I know that you have an American audience. I'm a Canadian. But, you know, the worldview in the two countries is very similar.
Right.
For the most part, it's based on science rather than faith in Jesus, although when I was a child, they used to read the Bible in school, you know.
Mm.
That's vanishing now rapidly. At any rate, I didn't grow up really with a strong faith in Jesus. And I met the Lord through a series of circumstances that you could call remarkable. You could call this a divine intervention, just like the name of your program. So I remember the moment. I was in high school. And there were a number of students who were friends of my older brother's, who's a year older than me. And I belonged to the Drama Guild, and many of my brother's friends were in the Drama Guild. And half of them became born-again believers. There was a little mini revival of this in Catharines Collegiate.
Oh, wow.
And, in fact, it even wound up in the local newspaper, Jesus Freaks Take Over the the smoking room at St. Catharines Collegiate. They used to call that room, they called it Holy Smoke.
Oh, that's funny.
at any rate, the bottom line was, I watched these people whom I had known because they'd been in, you know, they'd been in my home, right? And I saw a dramatic shift in several of them, you know, minor changes in most of them, but some dramatic shifts in several of them. And they started talking about Jesus, but I just didn't believe. I thought it was very nice that they had their own faith, but I didn't believe. At any rate, there was one day where I was walking down a hallway in the school, and one of my brother's friends, a gentle, sweet Mennonite girl, began singing about how the blood of Jesus had washed her free from her sin. Hmm. Now, and as I was walking down the hall, I became enraged when this girl was singing about Jesus' blood. And I didn't know what to do with that. I actually had thoughts of violence toward her going through my brain, and I was appalled and shocked at it.
Hmm.
And I didn't even know this, but I could say Christ and I could say God, but I couldn't say Jesus' name. And I became irritated when people talked about the blood or about Christ. But in this case, it was like I really wanted to do violence to that girl, and she was a gentle, sweet girl. It made no sense to me. At any rate, some of those people invited me to come and hear an English guy who was preaching in a living room with some friends, a Methodist guy. And he was this short little fella, maybe 5'2" or 5'3". And he was a delightful fella. But I walked in, he looked at me. He pointed at me and he said, "You will not leave." And suddenly it was like I had no ability to be able to do anything other than sit right there.
What?
Now, there was stuff in the background that was not good. I don't want to go on to great length about it, but my two aunts ran a strip joint and my dad had been a bouncer in that bar before he founded the restaurant.
Hmm.
So I don't have any question where this demonic presence came from, but I realized later on that I had an unclean spirit inside of me. But I didn't realize that while I was sitting there. This English preacher looked at me and he said that. And he was a remarkable preacher, and he was preaching a sermon called The Marks of the New Birth. Now, I had gone to that meeting to make fun of the faith of those people. I had not gone there to inquire. And when he said this word about you will sit there and you'll not move, I suddenly discovered that I couldn't even move my physical body, and I listened with rapt attention. And the most amazing thing happened. He started to preach. He rubbed his hands together. His glasses would sink down his eyes, and he would say, "Glory. Hallelujah. Have you got Jesus in your flesh? Glory."
Old school Pentecostal,
you know, and then he
preacher,
looked
yeah.
at the guy and he asked you those questions, you know. And I remember distinctly, he looked at that girl that I got angry at, and when he asked the question, she said, "Yes, I do. He's in my body." And he said, "Well, praise the Lord." But I couldn't say those words. Anyway, he preached a sermon, and it was called The Marks of the New Birth. And I thought he'd done this from his own research. And I wrote copious notes down. In fact, I still have the notes in my first Bible about what it was that he said. And then I found out years later that he was using what's called a standard Methodist sermon. He took one of John Wesley's old sermons, took the points, and used his own illustrations. But he was a tremendous preacher. And while he was preaching, it was like I was looking at him and he was shining. The only way I could describe it is there was this pulsating, gentle light shining through him. And then he did an altar call, and he said, "If you want Jesus in your flesh, glory, hallelujah, come forward and I shall pray for you right now." And I leaped up and I was the first one there and I jumped down and was right in front of him. Then he said, "No, no, not now. When I finish my sermon," he said. So there I was at the front. There was about 45 people in this oversized living room. And about 15 of us eventually wound up at the front of the room. And I knew about half of those students from high school. We were all of us between 16 and 25, something like that. At any rate, I knew some of those people, and he went to pray with this young lady, and the only way I could describe her is she was a broken lady, and I knew she was broken, and the room knew she was broken. This man walked over to her and asked if he could pray for her, and she said yes, and he said, "Well, tell Jesus you love him." And she said some pathetic thing, you know, "Jesus, I love you," kind of thing. And it was very obvious that it wasn't real. And so he said, "No, you don't mean it. Let me pray for you." And he put his hands on her head and he started to pray. And I had an experience where I saw in the spirit realm, he started to shine. And she was full of despair. You could see it. But as he prayed for her, the light that was in him waxed large. It flowed through his hands. It went right inside who she was. And she began to shine too. And then she began to cry these beautiful tears. And she said, "Jesus, I love you." And he said, "Yes, you mean it now." Hmm. And then he went to a girl next to her. And I knew her too. And he started to pray with this girl. And exactly the same thing happened to her. He went all the way around the circle, came to me last of all, and I kind of think it was, Dan, I think it was because I was the very first one at the front of the room. Anyway, I was expecting him to do exactly as he'd done with the others. And instead, he pointed his finger in my belly and he said, "Get out." I said, "Get out? That's kind of strange. What's this about?" And I looked up at him, and he was looking at my belly, and he was pointing with his finger in my belly. So I looked down. His hand was shining, pulsating with this beautiful, gentle, fiery light. And around the abdominal region of my body, there was an inky, cloudy, black mass. And he said, "Out of that, young man. Out you go. Out. Go out now, in Jesus' name." And he began to move his hand up my chest. And as he got higher and higher, the inky black cloud got higher and higher, until finally he came to my throat, and then this black thing flew out of my mouth, and it went straight through the wall. And then I had a magnificent vision of radiant light that was brighter than the sun. And then that light came inside of me, and then I stood to my feet, and I said Jesus' name. You got to know, that was my first breathing second as a Christ follower.
That's amazing. So this, so he literally, he could see a demonic presence in you and just cast it out?
Yes. The Saul of Tarsus saw Jesus before he was saved.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And I saw the anointing sitting on this man, this English preacher, his name was Pastor Derek. I watched the presence go into all those people in the circle, and then I watched this unclean thing fly out of me. It was the most amazing thing.
Now, when you saw this thing and you had this experience, what were you thinking at that point and, like, going forward?
Well, you know, at that point in the game, all I was doing was reacting to what happened. I was watching it with wonder and awe, because I had been watching with wonder and awe as he prayed with these various people around the circle. But when he was praying with me and saying this, of course, I was in this place where it needed to happen. I wasn't going to be able to leave, and I wanted that black thing gone. That's all that I can tell you. I didn't have what I call a cognitive scratch my head moment, apart from that moment where I wondered what he was talking about. And then when I looked down and saw it, it just was clear that something was coming out of me. And when that thing exited my body, I felt this fiery peace and joy come into me, and I stood to my feet and cried out his name. And I'd never been able to say Jesus' name before that.
That's amazing. Friend, you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio. We're visiting with Reverend Dr. David Chotka. He is the founder and director of Spirit Equip Ministries. His website is spiritequip.com. Now, Dr. David, going forward, how did this experience change your life, and, you know, what happened going forward from there?
Well, I was the first believer in my family, and of course, I had all these relatives who were involved in things that were contrary to Scripture. And so it became like the shaping thing that launched me, because I now knew that there was a supernatural realm. I started to dive into the Bible, and I could not get my nose out of the Scripture. I just couldn't. I became an avid reader of the Bible. I got myself I didn't have any money. I was only 16. But I bought myself a little cheap paperback copy of the New American Standard Bible, and I began to read it from start to finish, and found myself really astonished by it. And I became a student of revival, because the guy talked about the Methodist revivals and so on. So I started reading about Wesley revivals. I started to read about the transformation of nations through prayer ministries. And I didn't even know at the time, but it really shaped the direction of my life and what it is that I've been doing. So now, I mean, I'm an itinerant and I travel. I've been a pastor until the last couple of years. I was a local church pastor for 33 years.
Wow.
And my bishop said to me, "Hey, if I make this possible, can you write resources and travel and teach and encourage my pastors and so on?" So with his partnership, and in partnership with the church that I had served, I founded this ministry. But I mean, everything that I'm doing now was rooted in the fact that I realized right at the very beginning that the gospel is not just something you say yes to cognitively, but it's a supernatural gospel. It has to do with the conflict of the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of darkness. And it has to do with our need to walk in the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and not just organizing around our programs or activities. Although I do believe in the organizing principle. I've been a lead pastor of a church of 1,200. And if you don't organize, you're not going to run that church. It's just not going to happen.
Right.
So
you need to be organized.
I do believe in thinking and organizing. But our default switch needs to be prayer ministry, before we do organizational ministry, and that's not the paradigm in America or Canada.
Hmm.
In fact, I just did a clip for YouTube on my website where I look at Jesus' prayer life and compared that Jesus' prayer for healing prayer life. And it's remarkable because I can just say this to you about how I operate as a pastor. If I did anything that made the crowd grow, the elders and I would chat with each other about how to get more space and add more time and multiply the programs and so on. And if you read in Luke 5, verse 15, it says that in direct response to the healing ministry of Jesus, the crowds were just getting enormous. In fact, in chapter 12 of Luke, it actually says they were stepping on each other. We're talking about enormous crowds. And it says they were seeking after him. And then in verse 16 of Luke 5, it says, but he would go away to lonely places to pray. So he didn't let his experience of the spectacular aspects of his ministry distract him from his absolute need to focus on hearing the voice of his Father and being guided by his Father to do the works that he was doing, because the fountain out of which all the water flowed was his prayer life. And
amazing.
If God the Son needed to pray, that's a pretty good argument for you and I needing to pray.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, if you think about it, massive crowds and throngs followed him all over, and he was healing people, casting out demons, interrupting funerals, raising the dead. I mean, at one point, four friends carried a paralytic, and they couldn't get close to the house, so they had to actually go on the roof and make a hole and lower him down to be in the presence of Jesus. And that was faith and desperation,
yes.
I think, but that gives you an idea of how big the crowds were. And
that's the account I read this morning for my devotions. And so it's interesting you should mention that narrative.
Mm.
If you look right at that's in Luke 5. And the part that I read this morning in preparation for coming on board your podcast, because I'm going to talk to you about divine healing as well, was that Jesus did miraculous acts of power. And when the crowd demanded that he do more of them, he withdrew to pray more.
Mm.
And then he would walk in the anointing that was upon him. In fact, the narrative you described where they lower somebody through the roof is found in Luke 5, starting in 17, going on through after that. Now, it's an interesting phrase there. It's a fascinating one. It says that there was this big crowd, and there's this fascinating line in there that most people don't stop to reflect on. But it's part of what's in the Healing Prayers God's Idea book that I just co-authored with Reverend Dr. Maxie Dunn. It says, the power of the Lord was present for Jesus to perform healing. I'm going to say that again. It says, the power of the Lord was present for Jesus to perform healing.
No.
That means that Jesus of Nazareth did not automatically do miracles whenever he wanted to. Jesus of Nazareth cultivated his prayer life as God the Son and as the Son of Man, the one who was born of the line of humans, the second and last Adam. And he was required to see what it was that the Spirit of God was doing and enter into that action. Very, very striking.
Very interesting
point. And
that
healing miracle that you just described, where somebody tears open the roof and drops the guy down, it happens when Jesus is aware that the power is on him. And so there's this neglected aspect in the gospel tradition in most churches. Most churches just go around saying something like this. Well, he was God the Son. He was the Son of God. If he wanted to walk on water, he could walk on water, and he's special. And the gospel goes to great pains to tell us, especially the Gospel of John, that he did nothing unless the Father showed him or he heard it in the spirit realm. And that's the paradigm for prayer for healing. That's the paradigm that we have. And Jesus is not the exception. He's the role model.
Right. And you know, even the word says that those who believe will do greater works than Jesus even.
Yeah.
They'll do the same works and even greater.
That's right.
And, you know, Dr. David, I want to tell you a brief story about this. You kind of reminded me of when you talk about the presence of the Lord being available for healing. I had chronic back pain for 10 years from a torn cartilage ring and a bulging disc. And I had people pray for me over those 10 years. I had a lot of chiropractic and physical therapy. And I had stopped therapy probably 2 or 3 years in because I just figured nothing was working and I'd have to live with the pain the rest of my life, right? So in 2001, I went on a men's retreat with some guys from my church. And they were in this hotel meeting room and they said, we're going to pray, we're going to dedicate this afternoon to prayer to Jesus for physical healing. So if you have any issues, come to the front of the room and we'll pray for you. And I was like, you know, I'm not going to turn down prayer. I wasn't expecting anything. My friend David was online next to me. He says, Daniel, what are you going to ask for prayer for? And I said, well, my back, because I've had this problem all these years. And right then, Dr. David, I noticed that the pain was gone. So I was like bending and twisting and I didn't feel anything. And at that point, no one had even touched me or prayed for me. I was still online. But I believe that was an atmosphere of healing. Maybe that was where the presence of God was. And I believe he just chose that moment to heal me so I would know it was him and not, you know, doctors or medicine or anything else. But what you said about the presence being available and there kind of reminded me of that. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, yes, in the history of revival, you would have zones where people had prayed. And there would be manifestations of power inside those zones. That shows a particular thing with Finney revivals. There was a guy by the name of Daniel Nash who would go ahead of Finney into towns and pray in advance for the Finney revivals. And he would gather however many righteous prayer warriors that he could find in that town. And they would intercede anywhere from 3 days to 2 weeks. And there would be this profound sense of anointing over a geographic region. And then people would walk into town without even hearing anything. And while they were doing this, they would come under conviction of sin, or they would have a manifestation of God's presence and power hit them. They would become aware of what it was they needed to do to become saved, or some of them would get born again on the spot, even before they heard Finney preach, because there was an invitation for the Holy Spirit to manifest himself in power. And actually, you also see this in what happened in John Wimber's classes at Fuller Seminary some years ago. There would be zones where people would walk in and there would be a healing anointing. And you can't create the healing anointing. You can only invite it. And once the healing anointing is in the room, you cooperate with the presence. So the way I describe this in the Healing Prayers God's Idea book, I say you can't create a miracle, but you can cooperate with one.
Very interesting.
And when you can ask, and when you get a sense of the manifest presence upon you, you do this. So let me tell you a story about this. I don't want to talk to you about my wife's healing, but...
Yes, we're coming up on a break, so I want to get the pause for a moment, but we'll take a quick break, and then we'll come back, and I want to hear your story, and then also about your wife's amazing healing and what you've experienced in all your years of ministry, I mean, going all over the world. Friend, you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio. I'm your host, Daniel Fazina, and we're visiting with our special guest, the Reverend Dr. David Chotka, the founder and director of Spirit Equip Ministries, spiritequip.com. He's also the author of Healing Prayer is God's Idea. We'll put a link to that on our website, divineinterventionradio.com. But for right now, stay with us, and we'll be right back with more of Reverend Dr. David Chotka after the break.
We'll be right back with more from Daniel Fazina and Divine Intervention right after this. I believe in miracles.
Hey, this is Daniel Fazina of Divine Intervention Radio. The Bible contains some incredible stories of miracles and divine interventions. Jesus calmed a raging storm, healed paralytics, and even raised the dead. But are these types of events still happening today? The answer to this question, as you will see from reading my book, Divine Intervention, 50 True Stories of God's Miracles Today, is an emphatic yes. Contained within the book is a collection of amazing true stories that attest to this fact. You will read the astonishing firsthand accounts of people who have been healed of paralysis, terminal cancer, and tumors through prayer. You will see the love of God powerfully transform the life of an Islamic terrorist. You will witness the liberation of the demon-possessed, the resurrection of the dead, and much more. Prepare to be awed and inspired as you experience divine intervention. More information about Divine Intervention, 50 True Stories of God's Miracles Today, can be found at www.divineinterventionradio.com or by calling 800-247-4700. 1-800-247-4784. That's 1-800-247-4784.
Divine Intervention is supported by FarewellMortgage.com. With FarewellMortgage.com, you can learn how to eliminate your home mortgage and replace it with a home equity line of credit. This can help you pay off your home years faster and save you thousands in mortgage interest. My wife and I said farewell to our mortgage and replaced it with a first lien HELOC, and now we're set to save 25 years and over $100,000 in mortgage interest. More information about this better way to finance real estate can be found at farewellmortgage.com.
Have you heard the story about the terrifying dragon created by God?
Dragons, just the word, conjures up all these images.
They look like big reptiles with long tails, with scales, sharp teeth, claws.
They're carnivorous, and they're basically going to gnaw your face off.
Could actually be stories about what we today call dinosaurs.
Marco Polo is writing about dragons. Alexander the Great is talking about his giant lizard.
How did the people who carved that stone 800 years ago have carved a stegosaur?
Where in the world did all those images come from?
Do you believe in dragons or dinosaurs?
Try to explain away human encounters with creatures which we would call dragons.
Creation or evolution?
Clearly, science has shown this dinosaur died out very recently.
This is one of the greatest paleontological discoveries ever.
Man or God?
Confirms the Bible's history that dinosaurs and people lived at the same time.
Cloud 10 Pictures proudly presents Dragons or Dinosaurs, DVD and book. Ask for it at fine Christian retailers everywhere.
Divine Intervention is supported by the Other Perspective Media recording artist, poet Billy Lamont. Poetry, music, film, video, publishing, art, activism, photography, philosophy, Jesus. The Other Perspective 777, a sacred art sensory experience. More information about poet Billy Lamont's CDs, books, and Other Perspective Media can be found at www.billylamont.com. That's www.billylamont.com.
Hi, this is Jay Jackson, lead singer for Apologetics, that Christian parody band, and you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio with our good friend Daniel Fazina.
I looked up this morning with the Son of God. It turned out he knew me and call my name. You're lost, he said, but I can heal your soul. And now my eyes see a different way.
Welcome back to Divine Intervention Radio. I'm your host, Daniel Fazina. DivineInterventionRadio.com is our website. Friend, if you're just tuning in, we've been speaking with our special guest, the Reverend Dr. David Chotka. He's the founder of Spirit Equip Ministries and also the author of Healing Prayer is God's Idea. Dr. David, welcome back.
Thank you, Daniel. It's great to be here.
Well, I really enjoyed our conversation thus far. It was very enriching and enlightening and very insightful about, we were talking about some of the things you have experienced being delivered from a demonic spirit and also talking about the realm of healing or the presence of God. And before the break, you were about to tell us a story, and we were also going to be hearing about your wife's amazing healing from muscular dystrophy. Please do continue.
Yes. Sure. Well, let me start with the first story because it sets up the second.
Okay.
And as I said in the first section, I said you can't create a miracle, but you can cooperate with one. So one day I was working in the office, and I was pastoring a church in Chatham, Ontario, and the phone rang, and it was an elderly couple, a retired couple. They wanted to have a 50th anniversary renewal service.
Hmm.
And I said, oh, what a delightful prospect. What dates do you want to pick? And this is in the fall time. And they said, well, they named me a date in the spring, and we locked the date. And I said, look, do you want me to come over quickly? And they said, no. If the date's good, you come over at your leisure, and we'll set up a time. So 3-4 weeks later, the phone rings in the office again. They asked me to come over, and I'm on my way. I sit down at this beautifully laid out table with a silver tea service and pastries and cakes and that kind of thing, and it was obviously going to be a formal visit. And the man sitting next to me was at the head of the table. I was on his left side, and his wife was across the table from me. He looked at me and he said, we'd like to change the date to between Christmas and New Year's, Kent. Have you got time for it? So I pulled my planner out and we circled a couple of days and we locked one of them. And then I said, oh, are you trying to save money for your family so they just travel once instead of twice? And he said, no, I'm going to be dead in about 6 months. I have level 4 bone cancer.
Oh, my gosh.
And I have been, yes, I want to celebrate 50 years with the love of my life. And I know I can live till December. I will be dead by April.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, you know, the whole conversation changes. I mean, I was going over there for something joyful. I had my planner open to write down details about that service. And I'm in shock because this is a fine, lovely Christian family anchors in that church. And I looked at him and suddenly, I don't know what I remember. I had a pen in my hand. I put the pen down, put my hand on top of my head because I didn't know what to do with the information. And suddenly at that moment, and this is what I want to emphasize, I sensed fire coming into my spirit, married together with compassion, married together with peace, married together with command. And the presence of the Lord got bigger and bigger inside my heart until it filled my whole body. And then a hot tear came into the corner of my eye. And in my head, I didn't see a vision, but I could see this thing with the eye of my imagination. I saw myself placing my hand around the back of this man's head and praying over next to his right ear. And I looked at him, and of course, he's utterly unaware. He's giving me information about what he wants in his funeral, what he wants in his dedication service, etc., and scriptures and a hymn that he had his favorite one and so on. And as I'm doing this, I looked at him and I said, may I pray for you? Now, he was retired military. He was a World War II military guy.
Hmm.
He sat bolt upright, and he was in great shape, by the way, and towered above the table. He sat bolt upright, looked over at me, and he said, well, I'm married 50 years. My two kids are raised. We have grandkids now. They're all okay. The business is sold. My wife's okay financially. And he really changed the subject. And if you've ever been in the ministry any length of time, you catch these signals. That means, do not touch with barge pole, Pastor David. Switch the subject. So I try to write down what he's saying, his favorite hymn, a scripture that he wants in the anniversary. What does he want in the funeral? And he's telling me these two things. And, of course, this presence gets stronger, and it's like fire is burning through my spirit. And my hand begins to tingle. And I look at him, and I ask him a second time. And he sits up like, what's the matter with you? Didn't you get basic training? he repeats the phrase, married 50 years, you know, my two kids are raised, the business is sold, my wife is fine, etc. And he gives me a look like, you just didn't get it, and why don't you get ready for dying because I want to be at peace with God, you know, kind of thing. Anyway, I ask him a third time, he gets angrier, and I ask him a fourth time because my whole being is filled up with this profound sense that I am to pray for him. And after the fourth one, he looks at me and he says, why are you asking me these four times if you can pray for me when I have said no these four times? And I looked at him and I said, I believe that the Lord Jesus wants you well and that I've been commanded to pray for you. Would you allow me to pray for you? And then he relaxed, he looked at me and he said, well, you know, you're the pastor. If you need to pray, go ahead. It was like, okay, Pastor, I'll accommodate you, you know. So I reached around in the back of his head, and I put my hand over the spot that I saw in the eye of my imagination, and I began to pray, asking the Lord to heal him of this affliction. And as I prayed, it was like the whole room filled with the manifest presence of God. The air was thick with the divine presence. It was like we were breathing in a cloud of fire and glory and peace and joy all at once. his wife began to cry these gentle, sweet tears, and that man, this military guy, who was in great shape, actually put his head down on the table, every muscle in his body relaxed, and he said, "What is that fiery heat going into my body?" I said, "That's the presence of Jesus' spirit. He's joining you to the cross of Christ to bring healing into your physical body." And he said, "Keep praying." And so I did. And I honestly, Dan, I don't know how long I prayed. It could have been 10 minutes. It could have been 20. I don't know. You don't have a watch on when you're in the presence.
You tend to lose track of time in that in that zone.
No, you can't. Yes, you're in, but it's more than a zone. It's magnificent glory. You're in this place, and all you are aware of is what you're doing, God. And then suddenly the presence lifted. And he looked at me and he said, "What was that?" I said, "That was the Lord." And he couldn't get out of his chair. So I gave him a phone number. In those days, we didn't have cell phones. We only had the office phone, and we had my home phone. And I said, "Look, if you have any questions, you just call. But I'm gonna check in with you in about a week," right? So away I went.
David, what year was this about?
That was in 1998.
Okay.
This is one of the first dramatic ones where I learned this thing about being attentive to the presence.
Okay.
Now, healing miracles happen all the time in ministry, but this was a shaping one. And this is the one where I really learned to pay attention to this.
Okay.
So, he was 72 years old, right? And he was at peace with God. He's ready to meet his maker. And anyway, as I come home, my wife told me that he phoned. And he said every time he reads, that fiery heat courses through his body all over again. And what was that? And she explained to him that that was the presence of the Lord healing his body. Anyway, several weeks later, I'm in the office. It's a Thursday morning, and that's usually my sermon time to finish it up. And I just finished my sermon, and the phone rings, and my office admin assistant walks in. Her name was Linda. And Linda had been invited to the April event and to the Christmas one, and she knew about the cancer. And she said, "Ron and Marion have just called. They said you need to get over there right away. It's important." And I looked at Linda. She looked at me, and she said, "Do I cancel your day?" I said, "I think you better." So I got in the car. I drove over to this home. I'm sitting down at the same spot, at the same table, with the same silver tea service and all the dainty stuff set out. There was another formal visit with the pastor. And the man looks at me, and he says, "Got some news. Had a biopsy, got the results back." And then he leaned forward and he gave me a colossal wink. And then he said, "Cancer's gone. We know who got that." That was his conservative way of saying, "Praise the Lord, hallelujah, Jesus healed me." He didn't talk that way. He was a godly guy, but he wasn't given to, effusive emotion.
That's amazing.
And I have to tell, it's more than, there's the second half story. So years later, I'm teaching a class in our training center. I'm a doctor, and we have a training center called the Pathways School for Ministry for our training for the ministry. And I'm telling that story to the class, and a young man stands up and says, "Dr. David, can I say something?" I said, "Oh, sure, go ahead." He said, "I am that man's grandson. I was sleeping down the hall when you prayed for him. I was on night shift, and my grandparents let me stay at their home to sleep. And I got up and I came down the hall, and my grandfather told me that you had just prayed for him, that his whole being filled up with fire, and that Jesus had healed him." And he told the whole class.
Wow.
Years later, and we're talking that he told the class 2 years ago. And so we had a corroboration of one story on top of the other as I was testifying to that story. But that was one of the first times that I learned that you have to be attentive to the divine presence, and that you cannot manipulate that presence. You can only be present to the presence, and then cooperate when the manifestation of that power becomes profound or powerful in a room or upon you.
That's amazing. So that man was the military man. He was in his 70s in 1998. Is he still living?
Yeah. No, he lived to 82.
Okay.
He lived 10 more years, died of a heart attack.
Okay.
But he got 10 more years.
That's amazing.
Actually, I met him 6 months later, 6 months before he died. That was one of the last things that I did in that church. I moved to the Metro Toronto area, and I pastored the church in the city of Brampton. And then I accepted a church in Western Canada, and I drove down the highway, and I knew where the cheapest gas was in Chatham. I pulled in to buy gas, And as I'm buying gas, I had this remarkable sense of providence. I sensed the Lord was doing something, and I turned around, and there he was, standing right beside me, filling up his car with gas. And we had a magical visit, and then I went off to my next assignment. I pastored the next church for 10 years. But it was this amazing kind of moment where you could see that the hands of the Lord had done something profound and powerful.
That's amazing.
But the lesson in the story is that you can't manipulate the divine presence. You can only cooperate with it.
I love that.
That leads into the second story about my wife's healing.
All right, hold on. Hold that thought real quick. Friend, you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio, and I'm your host, Daniel Fazina. We are visiting with our special guest, the Reverend Dr. David Chotka. He is the founder and director of Spirit Equip Ministries. Check him out at spiritequip.com. And also, again, his book, Healing Prayer is God's Idea. We'll put a link to it on our website, divineinterventionradio.com. So, David, now you have another amazing story about your wife also being healed. And let's hear that story. And then after that, I'd like you to also tell us about the prayer you prayed about God giving you at least one divine encounter per day. I thought that was really cool, too.
Oh. Yes. Okay, so I guess I'm going to have to make my wife's story short. She, her mother, her sister, and her niece all were afflicted with a genetic deficiency called FSH muscular dystrophy, facioscapular humeral muscular dystrophy. And I knew when I proposed to her that she was going to be in a wheelchair at the end of her days, because her mother was in a wheelchair, her sister's in a wheelchair, her niece is beginning to manifest the trait, same sort of thing. And it's a chronic muscle disease that is what's called a plateau decline disease. So you don't see anything around it until you turn 15 or 16 or 17. Then your shoulder blades are out of position. You don't. If you lose muscle tissue, it's gone forever. If you damage something, you can't go. It starts in your neck and it goes down into your shoulders. It rounds your shoulders. It goes into your spine, and then you wind up in a wheelchair. You don't die young, but you die afflicted and unable to move your arms higher than your shoulders. Your back muscles decay, and you really have to fight to be able to do any kind of ordinary function. Wow. So we were married, thankful. We had a son. That birth of that son caused my wife to lose an awful lot of ground. And she began to decline rapidly, was walking with a cane, and was if she needed to go upstairs, she would have to literally grab onto a rail, balance herself on the step, then lift one leg, position it on the next step, pull herself up with her two hands lower than her shoulders, and then balance herself, put her second foot down, get herself balanced, and then grab the leg again and move it up one step at a time.
Now, what age would she be around this time?
This event happened in 2009, so she would have been about 50.
Okay.
And I knew that our latter years she was going to be in a wheelchair, and it was beginning to manifest in a big way, and she was losing ground rapidly. So we were starting to develop accommodations, and we actually were thinking of selling our house because we had a second story for our bedroom, and that was really hard on her. Anyway, the bottom line was we were doing this, and my church partnered together with a bishop in Africa who was trying to train and rebuild North Uganda after it had been ravaged by Joseph Kony and Idi Amin. And terrible, terrible things happened there. But my church and two other congregations of the U.S., one in Nyack, New York, and one in Atlanta, Georgia, we got together and we said, let's do what we can, train those pastors, do some build projects, and so on. And so once a year I would go there. And the bishop in that church wound up coming into my congregation to report to the congregation about the things that were happening in that rebuild in North Uganda. And while he was in the pulpit, he was an electrifying preacher. He spoke with a very, very thick Ugandan accent. It was hard to understand him. But the church was jam-packed with people because he had been involved in organizing intercessors, 300,000 of them, to pray for the Ugandan army when they were attacking Joseph Kony, that madman, who was that awful, awful warlord who would rape children and turn them into child soldiers and so on. It was just this terrible thing.
Wow.
At any rate, we'd met victims of this guy, and Kony was gone, but there was a story that involved a partnership between 300,000 prayer warriors and the Ugandan army. And he was telling the story, and it was electrifying. Everybody was sitting on the edge of their seats, and in the middle of his message, he stopped And the church was jammed. The sanctuary sat about 450, and there were about 650 people in that church, shoulder to shoulder, rammed up against the walls because they wanted to hear this guy's story. And as he was telling the story, he stopped and he looked down at me, and I was literally sitting almost on the front step leading up to the pulpit. And he said, "David, what is M.A.? And I said, "M.A.? I don't know, Master of Arts." And he said, no, I have something wrong. I haven't got it right. And he put his head on the pulpit, and he was silent as he prayed. And while he was with his head on the pulpit, everybody was waiting for him to finish the story he was telling about the disarming of Coney's army. And he looked up and he looked down at me and he said, "It's a wasting muscle disease. It starts in your head, it goes down into your shoulders and into your back. It afflicts you in your back and your back muscles vanish." And he gave a magnificent textbook description of the gradual effect of FSH muscular dystrophy on people who are afflicted with it. I was in awe, and I turned and looked at my wife, and she had been unable to raise her arms above her head for more than 25 years.
Mm.
And as he's telling this story, he said this while I was watching my wife. He said, "Whoever has this affliction, Jesus has just healed you." And my wife's arms shot up above her head for the first time in more than 25 years. It was the most amazing. Of course, my congregation knew us, right? We've been there several years.
Right.
Arrived in 2005. This is 2009. It was February the 22nd, 2009. I can tell you the time. It was 10:32 a.m. That was the moment when this thing happened. I'll never forget the moment.
That's amazing.
We had guests in our home, and we had brought them with us to church because they were checking out whether they should go with us to Uganda on the Build Project. And we went home for lunch. And the plan was that I would get the heavy pots and pans off the top shelves to serve the guests. My wife did that and raised her arms above her head and brought down all the heavy objects. And 2 weeks later, she ran up the stairs to chase my daughter when she was ticked off at her.
Oh, my goodness.
The Lord healed her.
That's amazing.
And then our doctor had been our doctor for 4 years. He knew about her muscular dystrophy, of course. He waited 3 years. And then he wrote the doctor's note. I believe I sent you that doctor's note because I wanted you to have that in your hand. But that story's in the Healing Prayers God's Idea. But I have to tell you this. Anytime my wife gets out of bed unaided, I go to Thanksgiving.
Hmm.
Because she shouldn't be able to do that.
That is
she
amazing.
Shouldn't. The Lord healed her of muscular dystrophy.
That is amazing. God can do anything. And, you know, I'm blown away by that story, and I think we have to realize that God can do anything, but sometimes he has purpose in pain and not healing, because you told a story also of how you went and prayed for someone and they didn't get healed, but yet that opened a door for another divine appointment. You know what I'm referring to?
Yes, that just happened about 2 months ago. So there was a family where the lady had a stroke. They were regular attenders in my congregation at Heritage Park Alliance Church. And the family, well, she had a stroke and she had cancer. And so here's what we did. I mean, it was a really Herculean thing. The entire family would gather, we would get on cell phones together because of COVID. We weren't allowed to go into that hospital. One of them could go. And we would all be on the cell phones and we would pray every night for half an hour every night. And she passed. And it was devastating to everybody because we were seeking the Lord for something delightful, marvelous, miraculous. She was only in her 50s, and it was very sad when she passed away, and they were loving family and believers, and there was no healing in that case. So here's what happened. I'm participating in the healing service, and I finish my role, and I am in the parking lot outside the funeral home, having just done the funeral service for this lady from my congregation. And I had a prompting to pick up the phone and call somebody that I knew lived about 10 minutes away from that funeral home because they were on the other side of the city. Anyway, I called them, and as it turned out, this guy, Ed, who's a regular supporter of Spirit Equip, said that he'd been unable to get out of bed for a month and a half because he had ripped the tendons right out of his leg. He did a terrible accident. And he was actually utterly unable to even get out of bed. He had to have a bedpan. He was in his 70s. And as I was talking to him, the presence landed on me again. And that fiery presence came inside of my spirit. And I said, can I come over? He said, sure. He said, where are you? I said, I'm five, ten minutes away. I drove over, and his physio, who was supposed to be there at that time, called to say that he was an hour delayed. So I had an hour with this man. And he and his wife, she greeted me and took me into the room. And there was one of these rigs for him to be able to sit up. And he told me that he'd been unable to move since this accident had happened to him. And he described in gory detail all of the tendons that were damaged and ripped out of place. And he was in excruciating pain. And I looked at him. I said, well, can I pray for you? And he said, sure. And I put my hand on his knee. And as I started to pray, that fire inside of me magnified. Once again, the room filled with the presence. I felt the power go into his leg, and within seconds, the pain vanished.
Hmm.
And I said, Ted, that's amazing. He said, it is. Do you want me to test it? I said, look, your physio's coming. Do it with your physio, okay? And I had to leave because I had another commitment for the day. And a week later, he drove his own car over to my home to drop off a thank you meal. He was completely restored. But
wow.
Now, here's the holy mystery. We prayed for that lady to be healed, and nothing happened. Although I'm sure she made her peace with God, I'm sure she's in heaven, I'm sure she's now no longer filled with any kind of pain or suffering. I'm sure she knows the goodness of God in ways that we can't begin to, because our limited experience down in this realm is so much of a shadow land compared to the glory of heaven.
Right.
But she wasn't physically healed. And seconds after I did that funeral service, I was praying with another man, and he was miraculously healed instantly.
Isn't that amazing?
And here's the reality. And this also happened with my wife. I prayed for her healing for 20 years. Didn't see it. And then when this bishop had this, it's what's called a word of knowledge, where he described the medical condition and spoke it, she was instantly healed. I mean, you can't be the one who orchestrates how God is going to do his work.
That's right.
The only thing that you and I can do is be attentive to the presence, and that's why that Luke passage is so profound for me. In fact, in John 5:19, it also says this, that when he does a healing miracle, and the Pharisees are wondering why this guy's carrying his bed, Jesus says this to the Pharisees, I can do nothing on my own initiative, but only what the Father shows me.
That is amazing.
I love
it. So David.
Jesus of Nazareth had to be attentive to the presence.
Yes, and as your stories illustrate, that can be done. And you, just like you had prayed for your wife for 20 years, I had prayer for 10 years for my back, and it didn't happen until that one divine moment. So, friend, if you're listening, I want you to be encouraged. Know that we are called to pray, and I think the results are left up to God. And sometimes it's a matter of timing. God will have his appointed time, but... So be encouraged. If something you pray for does not come to pass, that doesn't mean that God's will is not being done, and he might lead you to another door to pray for someone else. So I hope that's an encouragement to you. Unfortunately, we are out of time, but I want to thank our special guest, Reverend Dr. David Chotka, the founder and director of Spirit Equipped Ministries. Dr. David, thank you so much for sharing your testimony and encouragement on divine intervention. Really appreciate having you.
It's been a delight to be with you, Daniel, and may God bless.
Well, thank you. Well, friend, that about does it for another exciting episode of Divine Intervention Radio. I hope it has encouraged you to know that God is real. He is still changing the world, one person, one heart at a time. Check out Dr. David Chotka at spiritequip.com. I'm Daniel Fazina. We'll see you next time on Divine Intervention Radio.
You've been listening to Divine Intervention with your host, Daniel Fazina. You can email Daniel at divineintervention@mail.com. That's divineintervention@mail.com. All programs of Divine Intervention are available online at divineinterventionradio.com. That's divineinterventionradio.com. Join us next time here on Divine Intervention.